So we'll continue talking about Gaussmannian connections and related structures. So, a useful source of inspiration, as in many things, is this paper by Katsavkos, Kuntsevich, and Pantage called Hodge Theoretic Aspects of Mirror Symmetry. In particular, this mentions this emergence of connections with irregular singularities, which means the second order poles that came up first independently in Gromov-Witten theory and in singularity theory, and how they fit into a general framework. And then, if you want to see how the actual professionals do it instead of the amateurs, this is your deal, okay? And I will. I am puzzled by what I'm supposed to learn from that paper, but that's because I'm out of my depth there. Okay, so what I would like to explain is how this kind of Gaussmannian connections, things, operators which differentiate with respect to parameters, how they're a natural feature of S1 equivariant theories. And I really want the S1 to act, not just in some kind of, formal sense. So I will do it. So I'll do it from a sort of topological quantum field theory viewpoint. So what do I mean by a TQFT viewpoint? Okay, so we fix a coefficient field, let's say. Okay. And I want to look at what is a 1 plus 1 dimensional TQFT. So a 1 plus 1 dimensional TQFT yields. Okay, so if I have a circle, I have associated to this, some kind of space, which in this case here, it's going to be a chain complex. Of K vector spaces. Okay, and if you have this kind of structure here, which is an oriented surface with a parametrized boundary, then you get some kind of map of, in this case here, let's say, a chain map like this. Slightly more generally, so parametrized boundary means that every boundary component, so it's a compact surface with boundary, every boundary component is identified with S1 in a preferred way. And you can do this by, try to remember this by putting a marker here where the zero point of S1 is. Okay, and so more generally, given a family of such surfaces parametrized by a compact oriented manifold, maybe with corners or something, with boundary corners. P, we get a map, get a corresponding map phi p, which is now of degree minus the dimension of p. Okay? Now, there are various versions of what this exactly means, depending on what Depending on what kind of surfaces exactly allow here, but for our purposes, it is enough to allow. For instance, it's, you know, exactly how many, you know, you'll notice that the circles here are somehow divided into inputs and outputs for the purpose of this. It's enough to allow, frame disconfigurations. Surfaces arising from frame disconfigurations. Arising from frame disconfigurations. Okay, so what this means is here I have the unit disk in the plane, and I put a marker there, always at the same point, which I like to be vertical. If you like your marker to be at plus one, you have to sort of just lie down and stare at the board. Okay, and then you put in a bunch of smaller disks, those can carry arbitrary markers. Okay, and so that this gives you a surface with boundary, and it's enough to consider the surface with boundary. In fact, if you stare really closely, you'll see that for most of what I do today, in fact, I'm actually only using the annulus. Okay, but that's a can be might confusing if I formulate it in that way. Okay, so so this gives right. So let's see what we get from such operations here. Oh, by the way, sorry, I forgot something. Okay, so the okay. Let me not worry about this. Okay, so the basic axioms are, if there's a... Let me write it like this. So these operations that you get from families of surfaces, they're not always chain maps. But the failure of it to the chain map is governed by the associated family associated to the boundary. So in particular, if your parameter space is closed, then you actually do get a chain map. Okay, and there is the composition law. So when you glue surfaces together, and that corresponds to the composition of operations. Okay. Is everybody happy so far? Okay. So the actual content of what you get, part of the content, let's say, so okay, so this yields let me write down a bunch of operations here. So there's a you'd like this quite here first. So okay, so this is the product. It's just a single operation. There is the first interesting thing, which comes from a one-parameter family. Okay, let's say this guy here moves. Okay, the marker rotates. So this gives you a one-parameter family, gives you an operation of degree minus one. And there's also a bracket. Goes like this. You take two disks, you move one around the others, but the markers do not rotate. So they always point up. OK. Okay. You can ask, well, why am I not supposed to rotate the markers? Well, that's completely up to you, right? You rotate the markers if you want. That just gives you a different operation. Okay? So, these satisfy, in fact, you know, up to homotopy, two of them generate the third one. So this is a chain homotopy, okay, and the cohomology. So that guy here, is a BV algebra. Incidentally, this is lifted more or less from one of Ezra's papers from the early 90s. So, if you're trying to understand how this works, it's a good idea to think through what this guy here means. Okay, take that guy here. Okay. So you take these two disks with the markers points upwards, right? And that guy here tells you to, glue them into an annulus in a rotated way. So the result of this thing here was that the two points will move around each other, and simultaneously the markers will rotate. And you have to subtract the thing where the points don't move, just the marker rotates, and then you get the bracket. Okay, so. Okay, but actually, I'm mostly interested in the cylinder, which seems fairly boring. Okay, so note that so the square. So in fact, so what is delta squared? So delta squared is a family. So you glue one thing into the other, and then that thing into itself. And each of them is rotated by a certain amount. So the outcome will be that there's some marker here, which is rotated by theta 1 plus theta 2. So P is T2. The parameter space for this glued family. So delta squared means delta composed with delta. And this guy here is rotated by, well, let's say theta 1. Okay? But of course, you know, these are two annuli that you glue together. So when you glue them together, you, of course, forget the intermediate thing. So the outcome is that, you know, in fact, the only thing that matters is theta 1 plus theta 2. Okay? So in other words, you made a family. That's parameterized by the two torus, but where in fact only a combination of the parameters matter. One way to say would be that this family can be filled in over the solid torus. And by filling it over the solid torus, we get a homotopy. This is an operation of degree 2. There you go. Okay. So, as a technical note, you might ask, well, why don't I just say that, you know, somehow delta squared is zero? Right. That depends exactly on what you mean technically by axioms of a TQFT. But you know, I think in almost any kind of use that you actually want to put it to, if you try to force things to be strictly equal, you're in for a world of pain. So don't do it. Okay. So what happens is actually, and so this actually, so this is the beginning of a sort of. You'll notice that okay. So from TQFT point of view, so delta is. defined by a family of annuli parameterized by S1. Delta prime is defined by a family of annuli over something that's S1 cross D2. And these are the first two components of a sort of infinite hierarchy of spaces, which satisfy, so in fact, more generally, setting, you know, if we take the differential and I add D1 equals delta, D2 equals delta prime, and then there's an infinite hierarchy, then the equivariant differential so this guy here, so I introduce U, a formal parameter of degree 2. Okay. The equivariant differential here, D0 plus U D1 plus U squared D2 plus and so on, satisfies. Oh, D, let's call it D equivariant. Okay, satisfies. D equivariant squared equals to 0. Okay? So let's say we equip, let's say we write this guy here, C star U, with this differential. And denote its cohomology. In fact, you know, just so this squares to 0 at all orders. So the first equation is d squared equals 0, which we already knew. The second equation is that delta is a chain map. The third equation is this one here, and it goes on. Of course, I didn't really define the higher order terms. Okay? So this. This is a module over k double bracket u. Oh. By definition, there's something like this. Okay? So there's a long exact sequence. And if you look at it, okay, this is equivariant. There you go. Conversely, you can actually recover the action of delta on cohomology from his long exact sequence. So if you take the composition of these two guys is, of course, 0, it's being a long exact sequence. If you compose them in the opposite order, go from here to here, and then from here back to there, that is the induced map of delta. Okay. By the way, there's various different versions. Some people like to use negative powers of U, and so on and so on. But yeah, it makes no difference to the present argument. Okay. Okay. So this is the equivariant. I think, this is NS1 equivariant theory. In the sense that really the delta is really rotation of the circle. Maybe if you don't like this as a reason why it's an S1 equivariant theory, you can construct, when you construct these families, these parameter spaces P that give this, you know, delta, delta prime, and so on and so on, so these are all manifolds with corners, they have certain combinatorial structure, and one way to construct them is by using Morse theory in CP infinity, which models the Borel construction in ordinary equivariant cohomology. Okay, so far there are no parameters appearing anywhere. Okay. So now I will introduce parameters, okay. So what I'm going to do is a sort of EQFT version of the divisor axiom in Gromov-Witten theory. Okay, so we're sort of modifying the EQFT structure. Okay, so so instead of Well, we could still work over a field, but you know, let's say we could work over a ring R with more general, which has a derivation. Okay. So this could be, for instance, R could be ring of power series in one variable, and this derivation differentiates that variable. Okay, so we assume that C star consists of, I don't know what, projective R modules and carries a corresponding map. That guy there. Okay, so this is a map such that which differentiates it's a map that differentiates in the same direction here. Okay, where f is for f in R and x in C star. Okay. So this is my first attempt to actually make a differentiation operator. I'll ask for C star to carry a differentiation operator. Okay, that does not sound like a good idea, but give me a second. Okay, everybody understands what this means formalism-wise, right? I mean formally, as far as content-wise, I'm not asking that you get what I'm doing yet. Okay.
But should we ask?
Yes.
Should we be thinking of the derivation?
Just think of your theory as depending on parameters, and you try to vary those parameters. Okay, so R could be functions in one variable Q, so your theory has a parameter Q, the Kähler class, Kähler parameter, and you try to differentiate with respect to that parameter. Okay.
So ultimately we could have more than one.
We could have more than one, in fact, but in fact, we should have more than one, but one is enough for me for this moment. Okay, so the other one things I have to make. Sure. Okay, so the important thing is that this guy here is not supposed to be compatible with the boundary operator D, so it's not a map of chain complexes. Okay, so you could think of it like this in a sense. Well, these are projective R modules, so you can always find such a thing. You just write down the basis. And that one here differentiates the coefficients in that basis, okay? Now comes where I take the failure of it to commute with the TQFT structure and with the boundary operator D, and I express it somehow geometrically, okay? So also we allow our surfaces to carry an extra marked point. Okay. So this is some sort of insertion of a field. I don't know what you can call it, the Kodaira-Spencer field. Okay, which is formally of degree 2. Okay. So a consequence of this thing here is, for instance, I could take that guy there. That would be the empty configuration, and now I put in this marked point. So this gives rise to some sort of co-cycle. It's of degree 2, because that guy here is formally. So I put in one point, and again, I could allow it to get several points, but you will never actually see this at the moment until the very end. Okay, and I also would like to have. This situation here, where you have an annulus, and this point carries it around like this. So this gives rise to an operation R, let's say. So this is a one-parameter family, So it should give a map of degree minus one, but the marked point is of degree two, formally speaking. So this gives a right map of degree one. Okay. So I would like to think of this thing here, this specific family, as a very thin annulus, right? Because I want to glue it into other things and achieve a certain thing. So in fact, really, if you want to make the formalism work consistently, this annulus should have thickness zero. So you just allow a degenerate thing where this is just, instead of a surface, you just have a circle, but you have this point that wanders around that circle, okay? It's a common problem with this kind of formulation of TQFTs with surfaces with boundary. It's just like, you know, if you would like to have the identity map from C star to itself, you know, that should be induced by an annulus of thickness zero if it's supposed to be really the identity map. Because, you know, composing it with itself gets strictly the same thing, okay? So I want to allow this guy here. Right, so now come the okay, and I should also point out that R is homotopy equivalent to the bracket with K. Okay, so if you take this annulus here and you, instead of thickness zero, you make it an actual deformer to have an actual finite thickness, then you take this point here and you kind of pull it out. It's my favorite operation, okay? Then what you get is a one parameter family of sort of pairs of pants. And you can arrange for this to be just the bracket. And then so it's homotopy equivalent to the bracket with this K class. Okay, and now I put both things, okay, so I introduced two things. One is this strange operation here, okay? And the other one is the additional marked point and related by anything. Okay, so the differentiation axiom comes in two parts. One says the following thing is that, okay, so if I try to see what's the failure of this guy to commute with this, then that is actually exactly this map R. Okay. Okay, so this governs the failure of this to be a chain map. And so if I take a family with no marked point and I ask myself, how is the operation, what's the failure of this operation here that I have to be compatible with this sort of quasi-differentiation operator here? Then this guy here is phi p. This guy here, dot, where p dot is obtained by inserting a marked point. Possible places. What does in all possible places mean? Well, you have a family of surfaces that depends on, say, five parameters. Okay? Each surface, you can put the marked point anywhere on the surface, so you have two more parameters. So you do this in all possible way, you get a family that has seven parameters, and its parameter space is, again, manifold with coordinates, and that gives you a new operation. That operation, okay, so that operation has a marked point and it has two additional parameters, and therefore it has the same degree as the original operation, and this is the axiom, okay? If you want to differentiate multiple times, I would have to allow different, you know, you'll see that these axioms are kind of rudimentary, I should be able to differentiate a family of operations that already has a marked point and get something with two marked points and so on and so on. But then things become slightly more complicated. Okay? So this is... Okay, so what am I actually going to do with this guy here? Okay, so well, there's something obvious that I could do. I'm not going to do it because it's not really general enough. So you see, now we have the failure of this guy here to be compatible with the differential expressed geometrically as R, R expressed as bracket with a specific class K. If I assumed that K was a zero in cohomology, I could sort of wind the whole argument backwards, and I could correct my original operation here to be actually a chain map. Okay, so then I could make something that differentiates with respect to the parameter. But that only works, you know, that... So kind of boring, right? If we were in algebraic geometry and I have a family of algebraic varieties and I ask that the Kodaira-Spencer class is zero, then yeah, you can, the family is formally trivial and obviously you can differentiate, okay? So the trick is when you pass to the equivariant theory, you can make a differentiation operator in general. Okay? Maybe from time to time I should actually start state results or proposition. So there is a... Okay, so that guy here, so from this equivariant theory, that guy here has degree 2. Commutes with a formal equivariant parameter U that I put in, but more importantly, what is it? So if I multiply, so for F in R, right, it's actually a differentiation operator, not quite. Notice it had degree 2. There you go, f times plus u times df times x. So it differentiates in u times this d direction. Okay, my handwriting is too big today. Okay. Okay, well, first the rest of the proposition. And which fits into a commutative diagram. Okay, so you have this guy here. You set u equals 0, and you go down into the ordinary thing. And here it's the product with kappa class. Okay? So just as a pointer, so the structure of the equivariant, if you think in terms of ordinary equivariant cohomology from topology, in this context you're likely to be slightly misled. So the equivariant theory does not carry a ring structure, okay? And it is also not a module of the non-equivariant theory, okay? None of those structures exist, but strange enough, oops, sorry, there you go. Part of that ring structure, namely product with this class here, this degree 2 class, can actually be lifted to the equivariant theory, but only at the price of not being an operation that's linear over R, but instead one that differentiates with respect to this parameter. So this is the TQFT theory of the Gauss-Manin connection. Some things you'll be familiar from last time when I sort of reformulated the classical Gauss-Manin connection by, by multiplying it by this formal variable U And so this is its the sort of Griffiths transversality, which measures the failure of it to be compatible with the Hodge filtration. You know, before I go, there's actually nothing much to say about the proof, but before I can say a little bit, the basic idea is easy, and then you sort of have to sweat these infinite series of operations parametrized by higher and higher dimensional spaces. But let me, first let me talk about applications for a sec, okay? So applications. String topology. Okay. So let's say that N is an oriented manifold. And I take a class, say A, in H to N of Z. Okay. So we can transgress A to a class, H upper 2, excuse me, H upper 1 of the free loop space, and make a twisted version of string topology. Okay. So which means, so usually I would say that string topology is the S1 equivariant cohomology of the space, okay? But I don't know what to say this, so there's a, let's call it E. A, so EA is the CQ inverse local system determined by A. Okay. So this is has this parameter Q. If you set Q equals to 1, you get the ordinary equivariant homology. And so one way to think about it is just, take a loop. Think of A as being given by a codimension 2 submanifold. If you have a family of loops, whenever the family of loops crosses that codimension 2 submanifold, you multiply by Q, or by Q inverse, depending on what. Okay? And so this is invariant under rotations of loops, and therefore you can make a twisted version of this guy here. Okay? And so now, okay, so now this will carry. You apply this formalism. I mean, literally speaking, the string topology operations are just induced by surfaces with parametrized boundary. And so, you know, and then when you, it's very simple. What does it mean in this case here to have a surface and to put the additional marked point somewhere? Well, it's just you map the surface to N, and then you ask that the additional marked point should go through the Poincaré dual of A. Okay? And so that's, so we'll carry an operation of differentiation, let's say, in Q d by dq, since Q is invertible, just the rotational vector field direction. So the class kappa here corresponds to, is just the image of A, and the inclusion of constants. Of course, here you only used one class. You can use all the classes that you have, and then you get a family over torus, and you can differentiate in all directions over the torus. And that differentiation only exists in the S1 equivalent theory. Now, what's it good for? Yeah, I have no idea. But it's just an amusing piece, some kind of topological analog of the Gaussmannian connection, which sort of, makes a sort of unexpected appearance. Now, if you wanted to apply this to symplectic topology, okay, so in principle, you can you could copy this guy here. You could say, well, I do, I have some theory, which is a kind of flow homology theory, and it has, I introduce local coefficients, and then if I do S1 equivalently, I can differentiate with respect to local coefficients. The simplest parameter, however, that you sort of have no choice to include is the actual scalar rescaling parameter, or volume parameter, or Novikov parameter. Okay, so if I have M, a symplectic manifold, and H, a sort of time independent Hamiltonian, and then you can ask me questions about exactly what the point here is. So we have the flow cohomology, or flow cohomology, is defined over, well, okay, let me be nice to myself. If I ask for the Turing class to vanish, then I don't have to argue. So, okay, so this is defined over, okay, well, let's say, put a bunch of technical conditions. And the symplectic form, cohomology class of the symplectic form is integral. So then this is defined over this guy here. Q is the Novikov parameter, and you have to use it because of multivaluedness of the action functional. So the equivariant theory there's an equivariant theory which has an additional parameter, equivariant parameter, because H is time independent, comes with an operation which differentiates. And let's say QDQ direction. Okay, so here, kappa is essentially, is the cohomology class of the symplectic form. It's kind of obvious because the Q parameter has to do with the size of the symplectic form. This is a bit abbreviated thing. So what am I thinking of here, right? The compact symplectic manifold, the flow homology is just ordinary cohomology. And you can compute this differentiation operator, and it's what's known as the A-model connection in quantum cohomology, which is nice, but not terribly innovative. If you have a non-compact symplectic manifold, right? In fact, to be totally honest, it doesn't matter that H to be really time-independent. It can be time-independent outside a compact subset. If you have a non-compact manifold, you have, flow cohomology depends Hamiltonian you take, and you have all these nice theories, like symplectic cohomology with the Hamiltonian gross. And now you have an operation on that guy here, which differentiates with respect to the Novikov parameter. Okay? That assumes that you have a Novikov parameter, so it's not a trivial differentiation operator. And now this is a lot more interesting because this flow cohomology, symplectic cohomology, there are a number of ways to get distinguished classes in it. For instance, from compactifications of your symplectic manifold. Okay? And now you have a differentiation operator, you can sort of ask, well, let me try to differentiate those classes. And what differential equations do they satisfy? Okay, so you have a possibility of building an analog of Picard-Fuchs differential equations in this context. Okay. I can't help making this remark here. You know, from time to time, you come up, you know, you think about these things, so remark. So you can make, I showed you how to make an S1 equivariant theory. You can also make Z mod P equivariant theories just by using just only the finite group. So if you look at, the cohomology of the group Z mod P with Z mod P coefficients is K U T. Oops, should call this something else. Okay. T, H, U. This has degree 2, and this is degree 1. We differentiate the operator. In U direction. Let's say it uses U. No, it doesn't differentiate. It uses U in parallel with the S1 equivalent theory. With the S1. Yeah, with the S1 equivalent theory. Okay, this is, I said it very, very vaguely. But the point here is, what is the point here? Okay? So the point here is that now they're genuinely geometrically more examples. Okay? So let me give you an example here. Okay? So let's look at a string topology. Okay? So string topology takes place on the free loop space, and I can rotate free loops, and that's kind of important for this formalism to be applicable to it. What I could also do is I could say, suppose that I have my manifold N comes with a diffeomorphism. And instead of my loops closing, I ask for the loops to have endpoints which differs from the starting point by applying this map. Okay, so now you actually can't rotate these anymore. Well, you can try, but it's not going to close up as a rotation. Okay, but now let me suppose that my diffeomorphism is actually the pth iterate of something. Okay, so then instead of thinking of my loops as saying, okay, I start at this thing here, I go to some other point on my manifold, and that should be the image of the starting point under the pth iterate of something. I could also say I just go out to 1 over p, then I apply my diffeomorphism, I take another 1 over p segment, I apply my diffeomorphism, and so on. So once, and those are the same space, canonically. Once you've read like this, you realize that this space has a z mod p symmetry. Okay? And therefore, if you work mod p, the z mod p equivariant theory has the same, if you work with more coefficients and characteristic P, the finite symmetry theory now carries these operators. Okay? And the same thing is true in the symplectic geometry world, meaning, before I had to take a time-independent Hamiltonian to preserve sort of time translation, now I could take an automorphism of my symplectic manifold, which was a pth iterate. Okay? I should say, nobody has ever worked this out in detail. But I I did some experiments with P equals 2, which is didn't turn out to be the smartest thing to start with, because for P equals 2, U is equals H squared, which is kind of misleading, because it's always the U parameter that you use, not H. But anyway, I did enough experiments to convince myself that this seems to work in a reasonable way. But you know, if you wanted to actually do the whole thing, you have to build all the moduli spaces that are involved in the ZP equivariant theory, which I haven't actually done. Okay. But you know, so you get something that that TQFT produces something that actually nobody has ever seen before, as far as I know. This kind of, you know, finite symmetry differentiation operations. Okay, so let's go back and let's try to see. I'm going to go back to the formal TQFT picture, and we'll try to get an idea of how this operation here is constructed. And it's actually very simple. It actually also shows you the thing that shows that it's based on is the Catan formula, okay? Which is it's the Gauss-Manning connection is always based on, even in the classical framework here, okay? So what's the Catan formula here? Okay, so you have a okay. So I take this guy here. If you like drawing surfaces, you probably want to draw him like this. It's just a point in a random position. So that gives rise to some operation. Okay. In fact, iota is chain homotopic to the product with okay. Or I could do this other thing where I take the point and allow it to wander around. Okay. Or if you want to draw it as a surface, you take this marked point. Okay. So this gives an operation which I will call lambda. Okay, and lambda is obviously, I mean, except for the fact that I've written the annulus as having finite thickness, it's what I previously said as R, which is also chain homotopic to the bracket with this class. Okay, and so the Catan formula. Yes.
I'm not sure it's relevant, but are you tacitly understanding that capital delta of kappa is zero? Or?
It is actually true. I mean, it's homotopically zero.
Oh.
Okay,
oh,
so, okay. Well, look at it. So kappa is this guy here, right? This is kappa, okay? So what's delta of kappa? Well, I take this guy here and I glue it together. I should have said this. Okay, so I'll take this guy and I will glue it in some rotated way into this thing here, okay? So this is a family that's induced by S1, where this is the parameter. But of course, because you glued the two together, you're not actually remembering the seam here, right? So the family is actually a trivial family. In other words, it can be filled in from S1 to D2, okay? So this guy is homotopic to zero, and slightly more precisely, this kappa always admits a lift to an equivariant class, okay? So, if you are thinking about algebraic geometry, you may be slightly confused. Like, what does the Kodaira-Spencer class actually lift to? But in order to make the algebraic geometry fit into this framework as I've set it up, it would have to be Calabi-Yau, right? And in that case, the Kodaira-Spencer class, which is an element of H1x tx, also becomes an element of H1x omega to the n minus 1. And then you can ask, does this lift to the Durham cohomology? The answer being yes. Okay. So anyway, so yeah, so this is homotopic to zero. And that's Ezra's question. Right. Okay, where was I? Right. Okay. So the Catan formula. Says that. Okay. Well, what does the usual Catan formula say? The usual Catan formula says that the Lie bracket with the Lie action of some vector field is d iota plus iota d. Okay. This is actually not true here, obviously, because iota is a chain map. But in fact, you know, you have to remember the role of the Durham operator is actually played by this guy here. And hold on, and there should probably be a minus here. Yes. Okay. So there's up to chain homotopy. This is easy to see. Okay. So delta iota and iota delta is sorry is now yeah. Okay. Composing on the left with delta will just you stick in an annulus and the marker will now rotate. Composing on the other end will let this marker here rotate. If you do both things and you add them up, that's homotopically the same as leaving this point and letting both markers rotate at the same time at the same rate, which is the same thing as leaving the markers alone and letting the point rotate the other way. Okay? So this is fairly obvious.
So this is exactly the same formula that you just discussed earlier.
Well, this is a special case.
But the definition of bracketing.
That's right. The definition of bracketing, that's right. If I also did I could say the definition of bracketing with lambda is lambda is bracketing with this kappa, and then and so on and so on. But anyway, so okay. So what does this mean, right? So on this equivariant complex, right? We can try to correct the failure of this guy here to be a chain map by what? Okay. So the failure of that guy to be a chain map is expressed by this gentleman here. Okay. So I want to say that that gentleman here is zero in the equivariant thing. Right? Now the equivariant differential is not delta, it's d plus u times delta by adding u inverse times iota. Okay, so. And so in fact what happens is this, that when you define the actual connection, what it is like is that you can't add u inverse times iota because we don't have a u inverse, strictly speaking, but you just multiply everything by u. That's why you have to multiply everything by u plus iota plus and so on and so on. Okay. So here I'm suppressing a bunch of chain homotopies and so on. So if you try to measure the failure of this expression here to be compatible with the equivariant differential, right? So the failure of this guy here to be compatible with the differential gives rise to lambda. The failure of this guy here to be compatible with the with the equivariant differential shows up in this term here and also gives rise to lambda, and they cancel out. Okay. And so then you start sort of correcting these terms here. Actually, there should be a plus here. I sort of signs are not to be taken seriously here. Okay. So then whatever happens is there's going to be a bunch of other stuff that's essentially all of you. Okay. So there will be other conditions. So if you wanted, really, I could say, well, there's a failure of, so this guy here measures the failure by, okay, because it's homotopy to R. Well, let me just leave it. I think I could leave it at this, okay? And so if you remembered something that, oh, there you go, okay? Now you see why that thing is true. Now, first of all, you see, so these things here, these operations here, are all algebraic operations, in the sense they don't differentiate with parameters, they're linear over the parameter ring. Okay? But this guy here is an operation that differentiates in u times partial direction. Okay? Now you know why you have to stick in a u here. Well, you can divide everything by u, then you have a formal pole, and you have to sort of. And the other property that I said is that if you reduce u equals to zero, it would be the product with kappa, which is true, because if you set u equals to zero, all you have left is this guy's here, which is homotopic to the product with kappa. Okay? So this. This is as much as I'm going to say about this. So there's an infinite sequence of equations that you've write down and which gradually correct this guy here to be a chain map, and they're all based on higher versions of this Catan formula. Okay, so as in the classical framework, this is what makes the whole thing run. Okay, so I have 20 minutes, and I have two things that I wanted to say, only one of them is going to make it, unfortunately, and then I'll think about what to do. Yeah, I think the other one is just going to disappear into the maw of history, okay? So one thing is that there is a there is an operation which differentiates with respect to the actual equivariant parameter u. So you don't actually need any operations, any parameters for that. It differentiates with respect to the parameter u that you added, and which is boring in the case of integrally graded theories, and very much non-boring if you only have a Z mod 2 grading. Okay, so if you, for the people in symplectic topology, you know, everybody knows, you know, if you don't have Z gradings, you only have Z mod 2 gradings, but somehow the equivariant theory is trying to resist your tendency to not do it and comes up with another operation that sort of differentiates with respect to U direction. Okay. That I wanted to say something about curvature, because I can do that in 10 minutes, because I actually don't know anything about it. Okay? So, obviously the Gaussmannian connection is flat in classical algebraic geometry. If you want to express flatness, you need at least two parameters here, so you need to differentiate, you'll have two kinds of marked points, and you'll see what happens, the two marked points, and two kinds of marked points that give you differentiation in two parameters, will wander around the surface. When they collide, you'll sort of bubble off a pair of pens on which the two lives, and you'll get the Lie bracket of the two. I have not thought about it in detail, but you know, I think there's really no doubt that you do a multi-parameter, you have to allow two marked points to live at the same time, and then you will get flatness. Now, the interesting thing is that in characteristic P, there's a notion of flatness in one direction, okay? So, P curvature. Okay? So, what is this guy here? So, okay, so suppose that I have, let me work over FP for simplicity, because there's a bunch of Frobeniuses that I'm going to forget to put in otherwise, okay? And so let R be a commutative. FP algebra. Okay, so you think of this as some kind of affine variety, and E an R module, which carries operations of differentiation along derivations of R. So let's say it's, you know, it's whatever, a D modulo something. That means that if you have a derivation, so for some derivation D of RR, we have that guy here that differentiates in this direction, and we suppose that this is given, okay? And it's satisfies a usual equation. Okay, so okay, right. Okay, so we assume that this is given. Okay? Now, note that if this is a derivation, so is that guy here. Okay? It's a characteristic P thing. Okay, so pth power of a derivation is also a derivation. Okay? Now, let me look at the following thing. So I take this guy here and I iterate it p times. Okay? And I apply it to f times x. Okay? So my awesome calculus powers tell me that this is something like this. I can differentiate that guy here I times. I can differentiate this guy here J times. Okay? And this will be P over I. Okay? That all follows from recursively applying this equation here. Did you agree with my awesome calculus powers? They're indeed fearsome, okay? So now, but however, we are in characteristic P, and therefore, all that's left with you is actually the end terms, because the others are all multiples of P. So oops, some sex. Okay? And so you'll notice that this guy here, if I take the operation that's associated to this derivation here, then by definition, that actually satisfies the same thing. Okay. So this is the differentiation along the derivation that's the pth power of delta, which is not the same thing as this guy here. Okay. Okay, but by definition, this satisfies this. Okay. So the the P curvature in this direction is the R linear map . Okay, so these neither of these guys is linear with respect to multiplication with functions, but they behave the same. So if I subtract it, then you get an R linear map. Okay? And this guy here is called its gamma. It's called the P curvature. Okay? You can do it in any given direction. So it's like a, you know, curvature is a 2-form. This guy here is a 1-form. So you stick in one tangent vector field, and you get an endomorphism. And it's not trivial, you know, not trivial. Okay, so now comes the fun, right? So the first case that you want to look at is, you know, the Gaussmannian connection in classical algebraic geometry, but in characteristic P. So you look in Katz's paper, and you know, on page one it says, well, this is just given by actually the same thing we've encountered before. You know, the cup product, I mean, the pairing with the Kudara-Spencer class. Okay, but if you look carefully, he says, it's actually a twisted form of this pairing with the Kudara-Spencer class. Then you notice that the paper is 120 pages long and appeared in Inventiones, and you think there must be slightly more than this. And in fact, yes, it is the product of the Kudara-Spencer class sense. The way in which this is a sense involves the conjugate spectral sequence and therefore the degeneration of the Hodge-Durham spectral sequence and the Cartier isomorphism. Okay, so essentially the whole package that goes into Deligne's and Luzy's proof of the degeneration of Hodge-Durham in characteristic P. Hello, Akhil. So it's not actually at all straightforward, you know, what it actually, I mean, this description of the P curvature is, first of all, it's a partial description. It's a description of an induced filter, radiate of filtration, and it's highly indirect. Okay, so what happens actually, but, you know, in our TQFT framework, well, can't be as bad as that because we have none of those non-trivial ingredients, right? So in our TQFT framework, well, so now you have to assume that you have, you know, differentiation operators we would look at in direction, in this direction and in that direction, right? But you know, in geometric topological applications, that's really not an issue. We would look at what? So I would have this thing here, and I would have this thing that we constructed now in this direction here. So it's an operation of degree 2, and I would look at something like this. Okay, so there would be a corresponding thing for the pth power, and I would have to multiply by u to the power p minus 1 to get this guy here. Okay, and this has to be some kind of operation, right? And in a sense, what you really want it to be is you want it to be the action. So what we really want it to be is the multiplication with the pth power of kappa, okay? Because it looks nice, and that's pretty much the only thing we have, okay? The problem is there's no ring structure, right? So kappa doesn't actually act on the equivariant theory. But okay. So what we really want is we want to say that, you know, if you have sort of pth powers of elements, this is a ring, right? So pth powers, this is a ring with its product, that if you have an element of that ring, there is an operation on the equivariant theory that that acts like the like multiplication with the pth power of that element. Okay, this is slightly vague. So and then the p curvature might be the action of the power p. Okay. So the motivation for this conjecture here is quite simple, that you could say the following thing. Well, why don't actually ordinary things just act on the equivariant theory? Well, so there's this product, right? But the problem is the equivariant differential has delta, and delta doesn't commute with the action of things, okay? But look at this guy here, okay? So suppose I have, It's actually, you know, this requires a theory with several marked points, but it's not just true that delta of kappa is zero, but delta of kappa to the p is zero for all powers of p. So that guy looks like this. Hold on. I'm confused about what I was trying to say. Okay, so the bracket is the you know failure of this guy here to be a derivation, okay, and now bracketing with x actually does act as a derivation with respect to the product, so that guy here is okay. So in characteristic p. This is a cohomology level thing, so I didn't put in any of the chain homotopies or the chain level, but cohomologically speaking, actually the product with the pth power of something does actually commute with the delta operator, which is the first obstruction to lifting it to an equivariant operation. Okay. Now, obviously, this is as far as I get with the interpretation of p curvature in the framework of symplectic geometry. This is kind of interesting in a tingly way. Of course, you have to assume that you can work over z mod p, but you know. So then the thing that would be involved would be the powers of the cohomology class of the symplectic form, but powers in the sense of quantum product. Okay, so the structure of quantum cohomology of a Z mod P would then be relevant to questions of P curvature here. But the actual, so this is kind of a very superficial TQFT level. Obviously, the things that really bugs me, but where I really have no chance to answer this, is how do these fairly superficial TQFT operations, TQFT interpretations, actually interact with what Katz said? Right? So Katz didn't say it's the pth power of the Kodaira-Spencer class in some sense. He just said it's the Kodaira-Spencer class. But then, of course, he used the Cartier isomorphism and a bunch of other things, which, you know, themselves have powers of differential forms in them. And this will be the end. Okay, so next time, you know, I think it would be nice for some if we did some things, understandable things for a while. So I'm going to, you know, go back to this, one of the things that came up early in the lecture course, which is, you know, the intersections of Lefschetz thimbles and how we deal with them in flow homology. And I have a bunch of things to say ultimately about the structures that emerge in that context in what they're called Lefschetz fibrations, Lambda-Ginzburg models. But I think first we should agree, you know, on a basic symplectic topologist's, you know, flow homology level, how we're going to deal with, you know, Lefschetz thimbles being non-compact and the intersections and so on. And so I'll talk about that at least for once, maybe twice. All right. Thank you very much.